Kia ora koutou, ena mata waka, ena mana, ena reo, ena rangatirama, tēnā koutou katoa. Nau mai, hare mai, ki tēnei wānanga, ki tēnei rā, me te kopapa o te rā. Atamarie, it's a beautiful morning out here in the Waitakere where I live, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you to this beautiful day, and particularly this day of intense and short presentations. My name's Keith Tudor. I'm a professor of psychotherapy at Auckland University of Technology and chair for this first session. So I'm going to open the session with a karakia and then some introductions, and then let the fire commence. The day is called Ke te mura o te ahi, which is about fire, and so I'm looking forward to starting the ahi, the fire, in the afternoon, in the morning, in the ata. E te atua, kaha rewa, ane mātou e ako ana I te mana tika ki te tangata pehanga. Awhina tia mai, manaaki tia mai, kia mau nā kupu katoa ki te whatu manawa, ki te nākau. Mō ake tonu atu. Kia ora. I've just got a nice message from Heather saying she's loving the light, so I hope it's not too much. I can actually dim it. I may dim it later. So I'm delighted to welcome you to this first session. We have three sets of speakers and from an international perspective. But before I do that, before I welcome and introduce them briefly, I want to remind people of our community code. And this is a code that's been developed over a number of years to keep everybody safe in this space, because I think sometimes when things are controversial or edgy, we need to be particularly mindful. So we are curious, open and respectful. This will be throughout, and particularly in the breakout rooms, which I'll tell you about later. We make generous assumptions. That's an important thing, that, you know, we, rather than assuming the worst, we assume the best. Some people might refer to that rather fancily as the hermeneutics of trust rather than mistrust. Confidentiality, whatever people say in this space is held confidentially to them. One person, one mic. Please, you know, if you're about to interrupt somebody, just back off. Speak from our own experience rather than generalizing. I'll say they, those people over there. No one knows everything together. We know a lot. Sorry, I've got a little, is that correct? Together we know a lot. I just missed a bit of word out. Make space and take space. So make space for others, but also take space when you're taking it. We can't be articulate all the time. Sometimes I get a bit nervous and stumble and so on. And don't take ourselves too seriously. We're dealing with serious material, but we can also be a bit light about it. So that's the community code, which will be, I think, shown at the beginning of each session. So please observe that code. So I think without further ado, I will introduce this session, with where we're getting three lots of speakers. The first speakers from Canada are Justin Turner, and sorry, I've just lost the name again, Sunaina Chopra. They will be talking about wind gusts, bear encounters and data collection, which I'm looking forward to, stories of doing field research. Annabel Farry will then be talking about midwifery, what is midwifery learning and teaching without colonisation. And Rachelle Pedersen will be talking about Māori history being a freeing shaper, in embracing Māori histories to construct a good Pākehā identity. So we've got three really interesting presentations. And I would just like to finish my introductions by welcoming them warmly to this space and offering a whakatauki to support, since briefly translated as a proverb, to support their mahi. And the whakatauki is he iti, engari he ponamu. It is small, but it is precious. So without further ado, we will get into these small but very precious presentations.
That's great. Thank you so much, Keith. So the first presenters of the day are myself and Susanna, and we are joining from Canada, from across the Pacific Ocean. So really exciting to connect with an international audience. Yeah, like I mentioned, we're very honored to join you today from across the Pacific Ocean, where we're located on the traditional and unceded territories of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh nations. And we acknowledge with gratitude the long-standing relationships and sovereign rights that these nations have to this territory. Today, myself and Sunaina will be sharing photos and stories as Canadian graduate students doing field research in First Nations communities. And we really hope that our presentation can convey how our research journeys have changed us, because we agree with Cree researcher Sean Wilson, who said that if research doesn't change you as a person, then you're not doing it right. To share a bit more about myself, I'm a PhD student at the University of British Columbia. The background that I bring to my PhD research are my clinical identity as an occupational therapist, and my status as an Indigenous person. I'm a citizen of Métis Nation, British Columbia.
My name is Sunaina Chopra, and I'm a master's student in the Rehabilitation Science program focused on physical activity among individuals with chronic conditions. And I come to this work with a South Asian background, family ties to Northern BC, and a passion for promoting health equity. To orientate you all to where we are located in British Columbia, abbreviated BC, the westernmost province of Canada. And our lab is located in the southwestern part of BC in Vancouver. And as a team, we take a flight from Vancouver northeast to Prince George, where we would then drive to the various communities we partner with.
And in doing this field research, we work in collaboration with Carrier Sicani Family Services, which is an Indigenous-led healthcare and research organization serving over 10,000 First Nations people in a large geographic area about the size of Tasmania. And all aspects of our research are directed by this organization, and they actually initiated the initial relationship with our lab, with our supervisor.
And getting to visit the individual communities has been such a humbling experience. It really showcases why the Carrier and Sicani people have a special connection to the land around them, because this connection also influences their health and wellness. And this is why many health fair events are held outdoors as well. But sometimes, though, the elements can be unpredictable. And our team got to experience that during one of the events, when a gust of wind picked up our canopy tent, flipped it over, and one of the legs snapped. After a trip to the hardware store to get some tools and some tinkering, we were finally able to get the tent fixed. But as a whole, these experiences have been very valuable to our research projects. For recruitment, it was very easy to reach our target given the high attendance at these events. In addition, having in-person interviews rather than virtual ones have been insightful and rewarding. But research went far beyond just data collection too. We were able to grow our understanding of the culture and history of the Carrier Sicani people as well. For example, participating in smudging ceremonies, visiting a community's cultural camp, and hearing stories from elders, all of which provided us with a better understanding of their tradition.
And given the densely forested nature of the region that we are doing research in, it's probably no surprise that we've encountered our fair share of animals. For instance, we've seen lots of black bears, white-tailed deer, even caribou, which are pretty unusual to come across. And of course, lots and lots of mosquitoes in the Canadian summer. And really what all these encounters with the land and the animals and the plants in northern BC underscore to us are the historical and ongoing relationships that the Carrier and Sicani peoples have with their territory. And spending time in the community and on the land has been vital for us to gain an appreciation of that context and hopefully articulate it in our writing about it.
And as a team, these visits allowed us to grow closer with one another. During our very first visit as an entire lab, five of us stayed at a cabin together that sat on this beautiful lake. And because it was in June, it definitely had a summer day camp type of environment. So it was a lot of fun to be together for a week. And in subsequent visits, it was often just the three of us traveling to attend these events. And we would spend hours in a car together traveling to visit communities. Besides those events, we would also use the time to visit some of the landmarks in the area, such as Utsa Lake and Takaizi Lake. And not only did our relationship within our lab get stronger, but with CSFS in the communities as well. These visits allowed us to meet CSFS staff, like the Mobile Diabetes Clinic, and other key community members, such as chief and council members. Because as important as recruitment and data collection are to a study, the process of relationship building is even more important. And for us, that looks like facilitating bingo games, serving food to elders, and helping set up tents and tables at events. These actions have allowed us to return again and again and build on the existing positive relationship our lab has had with these communities for almost 10 years now.
Returning to the quote that I mentioned at the beginning by Sean Wilson, we can certainly say that as students, conducting this research has changed us as we've aimed to be respectful, reflective, and upholding of community sovereignty in our work. But more importantly is whether the research we're doing has made tangible and positive impacts for our community partners. And we believe that the fact that they are the ones leading the work we're doing, asking for it, and importantly, inviting us back in all seasons, spring, summer, fall, winter, through all kinds of weather, means that it is. And I'll just, there's two more slides. We just want to conclude by saying it's been a great honor to learn and work on the beautiful territory of Carrier and Sicani First Nations people. There's, of course, more stories and context to say about our work. If you want to learn more, we even recorded a podcast episode version of this presentation for the podcast Lung Fit. There's a QR code on the next slide where you can find out more about that. And we want to also express gratitude to our supervisor, Dr. Pat Camp, our funders, all the other collaborators involved in our work in the community and with our partner organization. And of course, all of you for joining and listening in today. Thank you.
Thank you, Justin and Sunaina. Beautiful presentation. And again, shows, I think, the preciousness of, you managed to weave in ideas about positionality, subjectivity, and impact in a very short space of time. So thank you. And without further ado, Annabel is up next.
I'd just like to say my title was a bit aspirational. it's changed a little. Aroa ki runga, aroa ki raro, aroa ki roto, aroa ki waho. Tihei moriora. Ki te taha o toku papa no Lebanon o kutipuna, ki te taha o toku mama no kotimana o kutipuna. Ko Annabel Farry tōku ingoa, he tangata tiri te tēnei. I'd like to acknowledge te kawaro amaki whose land I inhabit and te pūringa o ngā wai horatiu marae and my colleagues and ākonga in the pictures throughout the slideshow. In the next few minutes, I'll be taking you through the process of critical treaty analysis as outlined by Heather Kane, Dominic O'Sullivan and Tim McCrenna, and explain how it was applied to a level 7 midwifery course and show you the transformation. It's going to be a real whirlwind, whānau. So the problem is epistemic injustice, a pretty big one. Not all people participate fully and equally in knowledge production, use and circulation. Universities are spaces with institutional norms and values that reflect the colonial hegemony and marginalise Indigenous people. So the aim was to decolonize a level 7 midwifery undergraduate course using processes informed by critical tiriti analysis and mātiki mai. Kame and O'Sullivan et al. Say decolonization is both an individual and collective process of revealing and analyzing the historic and contemporary impact of colonization and institutional racism combined with political commitment towards the recognition of Indigenous sovereignty. Without the expertise of the specialist Rōpū Kaiako, this project would not have been possible. The Rōpū was a source of support and inspiration to grow understanding of resources in order to comprehensively apply the CTA. The rich discussions that happen inside the Rōpū was not always easy, but deeply valued, and the opportunity to caucus within affinity groups where we gathered as tangata whenua and tangata riti was welcomed. This approach was informed by mātiki mai, a consultation process led by Dr. Moana Jackson, Dr. Margaret Mutu, that asked mana whenua from across Aotearoa how they see themselves in relation to te tiriti or waitangi partner, the Crown. The process reaffirmed the preference for mana motuhaki or self-determination within te ao Māori. The relational sphere represents a joint deliberative body where ideas from both spheres can be shared to arrive at a common approach. So the Rōpū Kaiako set about analysing the midwifery course using the five phases of the CTA. Each phase provides a layer of analysis towards decolonisation using te tiriti articles, values and principles. There is not time to go through each phase in detail, so I'll focus on phase 3, determination. Here, Kame et al. Propose assessing your policy against a predetermined set of te tiriti honouring indicators to inform policy development, performance and evaluation. The Rōpū Kaiako adapted these indicators using Crown and Hapū Iwi resources specifically designed to inform education and health. And these new indicators were then used to discuss learning and teaching processes and curriculum content. So to go through the process, pre and post data collection was taken from the original course, Childbirth Complexities in 2021, and then the Rōpū Kaiako was assembled. And together, they applied the CTA process using the agreed principles informed by various resources, some of them here. And then that a new course was proposed called Responding to Childbirth Complexities, and that was caucused again as per mātiki mai. And then the changes were agreed in the relational whare, and then that went to the Board of Studies for inclusion in the curriculum. And then pre and post data was collected from this new course, Responding to Childbirth Complexities, and that ran in 2022. And we landed on this new course, which we called Responding to Childbirth Complexities, to capture the ability we all have to respond generously to the needs of whānau experiencing complexity. We, after the CTA, the Rōpū Kaiako agreed on a course outline that focuses on the critical analysis of the institutions and systems and on health ethics that can themselves cause inequity, rather than prior to the CTA, the focus being on the complexity as though they arose spontaneously. After CTA, the Rōpū Kaiako came up with learning outcomes that asked the ākonga to deepen an understanding of their own positionality within the healthcare experience and to show to grow capacity to challenge existing social norms in the often brutal realm of practice reality. The CTA encouraged the recognition of teaching and learning within the community and the necessity for ākonga to have access and interaction with grassroots community initiatives that are challenging social norms. And rather than prioritising deficit statistics in the classroom, the CTA guided Rōpū Kaiako to develop content that will expose racism and coloniality and how these form the determinants of Indigenous health throughout the childbirth continuum and beyond. The changes move the content beyond diversity towards a more reflexive, generative and responsive framework. The CTA gave the Ākonga Rōpū time to fully consider how the structure of assessments often privilege academic writing over all other types of expression. The CTA discussions led to assessment design that privileges creativity and oral tradition. These assessments ensure true relational engagement and interaction with the and the Ākonga seem to enjoy. The doctorate will use mixed methods to report on the Ākonga experience of engaging with the co-design course. Kia ora.
Oh, tēnā koe e hoa that. Seeing all the chat comments, you know, it's just incredible work and so much in that to unpack. I hope those who go to the next 15 minutes will get an opportunity to unpack that with you, Annabel.
I hope so. It was a lot. So
And as a fellow academic, I particularly like the sort of translation learning outcomes. I think that was very creative. So I want to add, you know, also mihi to your creativity.
Kia ora.
So thank you. And last but not least, Rachelle is on. And
We go. Kia ora. Kia ora koutou. So today I am presenting a published paper titled Māori Can Be a Freeing Shaper, Embracing Māori Histories to Construct a Good Pākehā Identity. So within this sort of current times of intense change and debates around racism, Māori challenges to Pākehā dominant society have created an environment of shifting social expectations for Pākehā around how to address and manage our relationship with Māori, Te Tiriti o Waitangi, and the history of colonisation. As a Pākehā, I am interested in how my people are responding to these calls for change with a view towards social justice aims. Using the instigation of compulsory teaching of New Zealand histories in schools as a case study focus, my aim was to identify how left liberal or progressive Pākehā who embrace Māori histories, versions of history, navigate what it means for our identity and our relationship with Māori to embrace that history. So the national Pākehā identity has historically been underpinned by colonial versions of history, which ignore or conceal the Crown's treaty breaches. These histories have exerted a form of lovely knowledge or a discourse which allows Pākehā to visualise their role within the nation's story as benign, altruistic, and at times even heroic, pulling towards a harmonious and resolved settler-Indigenous relationship. These discourses are reflected in the data source for this study, which was mainstream media articles. Historically, these media have produced dominant anti-Māori themes, which have worked to naturalise Pākehā centrality and authority while delegitimising Māori sovereignty as First Peoples. These themes have created a strong but very limited range of discursive resources from which Pākehā and also other tauiwi have been able to choose from to describe relations with Māori and issues of Pākehā identity. So the recent instigation in schools of authorised histories that do not avoid the violence of colonisation may unsettle these Pākehā identities that are based in a cohesive colonial nation. They may also produce a shift in the discursive resources available for Pākehā to use in any reconstruction of identity that they may be navigating in this moment of social change. So this analysis focused on 9 articles that supported the prioritisation of Māori histories in the curriculum. The analysis was critical and was grounded in a social constructionist epistemology. I conducted both a reflexive thematic analysis and a discourse analysis that built up a detailed picture of what work was being achieved in the data around the way power is constructed and maintained. These articles generally welcomed Māori knowledge and language into mainstream New Zealand life. Māori histories were framed as truth and the solution to racism. This diverges from earlier identified anti-Māori themes in that they are not based in an obvious white supremacy, but in the kind of idea of Māori and Pākehā as two different but equally capable peoples. However, because Pākehā are still centralised as the dominant unspoken group, the discourses were available to be used predominantly by Pākehā. They underpinned the construction of what I have called a good Pākehā identity position, described in the data as better, stronger, mature, and enlightened. The key way this was constructed was through comparing this good Pākehā favourably to a white racist outgroup, which was framed as the source of any current problems. They were described as naysayers, myth believers, and the racist underbelly. This enabled good Pākehā to become separated from any intolerance or racism toward Māori and therefore irreproachable. So in the data, the good Pākehā became good by engaging in the necessary work of facing and learning history. The construction centered on Pākehā's self-development through learning about history as the catalyst for progressive change. The work was constructed as emotional and centralized good Pākehā emotions such as guilt, while Māori emotions were completely absent. This hard work was framed as culminating in the creation of a transcendent, liberated Pākehā individual and nation that enjoys ideal race relations. These discursive resources can be used by Pākehā to navigate the current social changes and maintain their centered position of privilege. So even though these articles focused on Māori perspectives of history, which should really then center Māori worldviews and emotions, they effectively worked to re-center Pākehā. They enlisted Māori histories to work in the discursive emergence of a new good Pākehā identity, while continuing to marginalise Māori experiences. Missing from the data is any problematising of structural or institutional racism or identification of how history has created current Pākehā privilege. And avoiding this while constructing Pākehā individual learning work as the solution works to pull the narrative back towards that harmonious relationship between Māori and Pākehā, placing Pākehā again in a morally sound position after the work has done. And my own personal reflections in this work have revolved around how easy it can be as a Pākehā to orient towards individualized transformation as the solution, based on an underlying anxiety of being seen to be doing the right thing. Some of my conclusions form around what might actually be required of us as Pākehā. And these might be seeing ourselves as more of a collective group and taking responsibility for that group, and two, orienting towards justice instead of our own feelings or transformation. So in conclusion, the analysis indicates that the discursive resources needed for substantive social and political change are not yet presented even in these ostensibly pro-Māori media that we analysed. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Raquel. Amazing work and a very very optimistic work, actually. I mean, it's hard, but it feels like that you're pointing towards a much more progressive, inclusive future, which is very heartening as we start this day. So thank you one and all. And we now go into breakout rooms for 15 minutes. And those of you who've been attending the rest of the event, these breakout rooms will be different in that they're more like the traditional Zoom meeting where there's, you know, cameras are on and people are talking with each other. So it's even more important to bear in mind the community guidelines. So choose your breakout rooms and we'll see you in 15 minutes back to say a few closing words. We've just come back. Hopefully you've had some stimulating conversations in the breakout rooms. I know we did, getting through a lot of work. And it only remains for me to close this session by thanking again Justin, Sunaina, Annabel and Raquel for very stimulating presentations in the spirit of the chit chat that it really does prove the point that I tried to make, and I had just lost the wording of the whakatauki, aha kia te iti he ponamu. So notwithstanding that these are short, little presentations, they are per nāmu, they are very beautiful and stimulating presentations for us to continue to think about. I know I'm making all sorts of connections and want to follow up various conversations. So, nō reira, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. Thanks to all, and all the best for the rest of the day. No doubt we'll be seeing you in different sessions. So I think that's a wrap, as they say.